The following video presents the new features in Pit Stop 12, Update 3. Let us start with an important change related to operating system version support. Pit Stop is now supported on OS X 10.10, also known as Yosemite. When mapping Gray to CMYK, you now see an additional user interface that lets you define the 100% equivalent of the CMYK color you are mapping to. This is especially interesting when the gray color you are mapping is not set to 100%, which in the case of device gray means it is black. The global change to apply curves was introduced in Pit Stop 12 Update 2, and we have improved it by adding two reset options. One is to reset the list of channels to the original ones, and one is to reset all curves to the initial state. It is now more convenient if you have to get rid of multiple settings. There is now a proportional lock in the inspector that can be used for proportional resizing of objects or page boxes. The bulk of the new functionality in Update 3 lies in the action lists. A few existing actions have been extended, and lots of new ones have been added. Here's an overview. The list of internal pit stop variables that you can use when adding text with the Add Object action has been extended to include a variable for the page box dimensions. The units are, of course, those of your preferences. The same variable is also available in the global change Add Variable Text. The action Add Separation Names has a new option to have all the separation names in the same location so they overprint each other. The actions Replace Page Content by Bitmap and Rasterize Page Content Keeping Text have two new options, one to honor the overprint settings of the original PDF objects, the other to define the target color space of the image being created. There is a new action, Add Color Bar, that automatically generates a color bar using the document colors of each individual page. You can set the size of the patches and the tint values. You can choose if the patches should repeat over the page or not, and a few other settings that are really easy to understand. There were, at least for us, a surprising number of customers who requested the next action on our list, Match Fill and Stroke Colors. This lets you change the stroke of an object to be identical to the fill or vice versa. Another frequently requested action is that to flatten annotations. Here you see a few annotation types and how they are converted to graphic objects. Note that sticky notes are converted to a sticky note symbol. The text and the arrow of the annotation are not converted. We have added a lot of new functionality to the actions related to layer handling. Before listing the new actions, let me first explain what layers in a PDF file really are, or some of this functionality may be unclear. For PDFs created by desktop publishing authoring applications, a layer in the PDF file will correspond to a layer in the originating application. Here you see an InDesign file with a few layers, and in the PDF version of that file, we see the same layers. However, it is important that you realize that in a PDF file, this is not a requirement. The PDF technical term for a layer is an optional content group, abbreviated as an OCG. It allows the grouping of a variety of objects so you can show them as a group or hide them as a group. It would be incorrect to assume that objects in an OCG that are above another OCG also have to be above the objects in the other OCG. Here you see that the objects in the top layer are actually below the objects in the bottom layer. While one object can belong to multiple layers or OCGs, it is not a requirement for an object to belong to an OCG. Here is an overview of the layer-related actions. Select Layers. This action simply selects all layers. Select Layer by Name. This is straightforward, but note the ability to use regular expressions and smart preflight variables for the name. Rename Layer. This may also seem easy enough, but there are a few things to consider. When you select multiple layers using a regular expression and you rename them to a single name, you will get multiple layers with the same name. Another perhaps surprising property of optional content groups that is different from the layers of a desktop publishing application. When renaming, you can use a regular expression technique called grouping and back referencing. In the from field, you put the part of the layer name you want to keep in between round brackets. This is the grouping part. In the To field, enter \1 to reference the first group. That is the back referencing part. And in this example, the word layer replaces the word test at the beginning of the layer name, but not when it appears somewhere else, and the rest of the name is left untouched. Flatten layers. This action must be preceded by either a select layers or a select layers by name action. The result is that while the layer is removed from the list, the objects remain. What took place is simply that the objects are no longer grouped. Everything else about the objects that belong to the optional content group has not changed. Note that this flattening has nothing to do with the flattening of transparencies. Flatten objects in layer. This action must be preceded by one or more select actions. The selected objects are then removed from the layer or layers that they belong to. Should a layer become empty as a result, it will also be removed, as is the case for the flatten layers action. So as you can see in this example, all the texts are now no longer part of any layer, and one, but not both layers, were flattened. Whereas the previous action removed specific objects from all layers, the remove objects from layers action can do so for specific layers. So it is logical that this action has to be preceded by two selections. First, you select the layer or layers in question, then the objects, and here is the result. Not only can you remove objects from layers, you can also add objects to layers. Not surprisingly, there is an action called Add Objects to Layer. It already existed in previous versions, but its behavior has been changed. It now must be preceded by two select actions. The first selects the layer or layers, the second the objects. As it is based on two selections, this action does not do anything when one or both of the selections are empty. In other words, this action can only add objects to an existing layer. Note the option to remove or not remove the selected objects from the layer to which they had already belonged, illustrating the property that objects can belong to more than one optional content group. If you want to add objects to a layer that may or may not exist, you should use Add Objects to Layer with Name. This action works on the selected objects, all black text in this example, and puts it on a layer named Black Text. It will be clear by now that you could find yourself with empty layers in a file. There is an action to check for that, and there is also an action to remove them. Finally, there are two actions relating to the properties of layers, Check Layer Properties and Change Layer Properties. The main purpose of these is to check and change the visibility settings of certain layers. When PitStop Server is used in a switch environment, it will silently install a new version of the PitStop Server configurator. There were several bug fixes and improvements compared to the previous version. To activate the new version of this configurator, simply restart Switch Server. Thank you for watching this video, and have fun with the new features in PitStop 12, Update 3.